Okay, and before we get into this broadcast, I want to make damn sure to get this cleared up. Throughout this broadcast, we use the term sovereign citizen as the catch-all for those participating in or promoting patriot mythology. As I put in my article on the National Liberty Alliance, which I'll link into the show notes, quote, "It would behoove me to first say that the identifier sovereign citizen is an oxymoron, a contradiction in terms, if you will. A sovereign is above all else. A citizen is a legally recognized subject of a state, thereby subordinate to a larger body." Although I'll use that identifier throughout this article, simply due to its notoriety and for purposes of clarity, because the tactics pursued by folks with these different labels, i.e. American state national, freeman on the land, etc., are almost identical, end quote. Now, when that jackass commenter on YouTube reads the title that we're going to put on this broadcast and responds with, "There is no such thing as a sovereign citizen, that's an oxymoron," and it will happen, I assure you, I can know for sure that the individual didn't even bother to listen to the first minute of this broadcast and doesn't warrant any of my attention. That said, thanks for tuning in to another LUA Radio Special Edition. This is being recorded on November 2nd, but we'll be premiering live on the November 3rd broadcast over on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network for our Thursday slot. I'm your host, Shane, and with me is the LUA Creative Consultant, Kyle Rearden. You can find his work at thelastbastille.com. So welcome back to the show, sir. How's it going?
Going pretty well, man. It's always good to... basically called attention to certain misdeeds that are being committed with folks that are, how shall I say, have ulterior motives, perhaps?
Yeah, yeah. And I remember when we got done, and we'll get more into this later on, but when we finished this, our last broadcast, or our last special edition on the Sovereign Citizens, we thought that we might be done. But we knew better, didn't we, Kyle?
Yeah, apparently. They're not letting up, at least not yet.
Nope. Nope. Definitely not. Definitely not. So the plan for this broadcast, and it'll kind of be tied with voting again, but I think it'll flow pretty well. I'm going to discuss the meeting I had with some folks from a campus organization, Turning Point USA. Then we'll get into the last show that Kyle and I did when he was on LUA radio for a live broadcast, discussing the Electoral College. And then we'll get into canceling the voter registration, something that we definitely promote and something that people are finally starting to kind of take up. So that's very good. But I came across, I don't really know the right way to put it, because this was out in 2000. This document we're going to be referring to much later on in the broadcast was put out in 2009. So I guess I found an alternative way to cancel the voter registration. And let me just say, I was not pleased with the document, and the parallels within this document are very similar to the sovereign citizens, the documents they like to put into court and things. So that's going to be what we're discussing tonight. But first, I want to just lay out my experience with finally meeting some folks from a campus organization. So some context. I had been seeing some posters around from that group, Turning Point USA, on campus. They had taxation is theft ones, some other great posters. I think one was like, if you gave the government control of the desert, they'd run out of sand in a year or something like that. So comical stuff. So obviously they promoted free markets too, and they're against political correctness. So I said, you know, I'll step outside of my bubble and I'll go and do something I wouldn't normally do. So I went and met up with a few folks from that group. And obviously they've got to have their titles and things. So I asked the president, who I think he's like 18 years old, I asked him what their goal or mission was. And it wasn't even like the typical libertarian pitch, Kyle. It was where it's like socially conservative and fiscally or whatever, you know what I'm talking about. Socially conservative and fiscally responsible, whatever it is. It was more of a conservative pitch. I mean, they mentioned fiscal responsibility against political correctness, free speech, free markets, etc. So, I mean, I wasn't completely turned off when I met them, but when I got home, because I was doing some, I guess, more research, because I was going to go to their meeting they had on Monday and meet some of the folks. But when I went back into the group to see what they were talking about, they were looking for volunteers to flyer for Trump. So yeah, it turns out this organization, one that obviously I know not to get hopeful anymore. When it comes to stuff happening in higher-level indoctrination. But yeah, it turns out they're just a bunch of Trump humpers and Blue Lives Matter folks. So, Kyle, still no freedom or free market group at Illinois State's that I'm able to find. Although I can't be surprised. I guess if I want that, I'll have to start it myself, and I'm not that invested in the college experience or the politics there at ISU per se. So, what do you think?
Well, I'm sorry that your latest political field trip did not turn out so well, but you know, this is what happens when people want to work inside the system and kowtow to the prejudices of the left-right paradigm, you know, the two-winged same bird of prey, which of course is the state. So, you know, I'm sorry that they weren't willing to be at least socially liberal but fiscally conservative.
There you go.
like the partyarchy of the LP wants to do. But yeah, I mean, man, this is just kind of typical. I mean, why? I mean, folks have wondered for years why I've criticized so-called activists of various ideologies, and it's because they do this crap.
Yeah. That is definitely true. And it kind of brings to mind, and I guess this is why we did that broadcast on 1023, which I titled, "Oh, you think your vote matters in a presidential election? That's cute." But this is kind of, I guess, just a common misunderstanding of the American political system, which you so kindly narrated, wrote the transcript and narrated a video for that's on the YouTube channel, which is actually doing very, very well now. So maybe we're doing some good on that one. Maybe we'll deter some people from going and casting a vote for Trump, Hillary Clinton, or Stein, or any of the other names that will be on the presidential ballot. But yeah, it kind of brings to mind that broadcast that we did, where they've never really been told the truth about the Electoral College and higher level indoctrination. Because I was obviously doing some creeping around on Facebook to see who was in this group, and a lot of them are political science majors. And I remember you read some of the stuff from your textbook in that broadcast, and some of them lie, some of them tell half-truths, whatever it may be. But yeah, they're definitely not getting told the truth about the Electoral College system, or they wouldn't be out flying for Trump and things. But I guess, in short, just to kind of summarize that broadcast, your vote in the presidential election is completely irrelevant unless you are an elector. Obviously, me being an anarchist, I'm sure Kyle will agree with me on this. I would extrapolate that out to all elections, honestly. Participating in politics is begging the masters, and freedom has never and will never be won through the political means. Now, I also believe it's a violation of the twin axioms, the non-aggression principle and self-ownership, but I would say the former 2 points are more important and prudent, in my opinion, especially in regards to, I guess, elections in general. So anything you want to mention there?
Sure. I mean, even if we were to kind of disregard our own principles or otherwise put them aside for a moment, the fact of the matter is that these authoritarian sycophants are not even following the government's own monopoly laws, or hell, even when the patriots like to, you know, throw up a constitution every once in a while, the Electoral College is constitutional, only modified by the 12th Amendment, but it was never abolished. Mm-hmm. So people who like to place a lot of faith in presidential campaigns really don't understand the Constitution, regardless of whether they like it or hate it. They don't understand it. They do not comprehend, or otherwise, maybe a better way of putting it is, they believe the corporate mainstream line that the president is elected by the popular vote, which, of course, is a flat, bald-faced lie. And so far, mm-hmm. apparently that seems to be the case, that their belief in fairy tales and myths is more important than the laws that they claim the rest of us must obey, no matter how unjust they are.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'll mention this again just for special emphasis, but this is so most blatantly shown, in my opinion, from the Texas Election Code, which we read that, and that's linked into the show notes for the 1023 broadcast. You can find that there at libertyunderattack.com. But the electors of in Texas don't meet until, well, I don't remember they can't make anything simple, Kyle, but this year it'll be December 19th. So you'll go, well, hopefully listeners of this broadcast won't go do this, but more generally, people will go and vote on November 8th and think that that the president is elected popularly, and then the electors in Texas won't determine or won't cast their votes until December 19th. So I think that's the most blatant example of how the I guess the American people and voters have been completely misled.
Yes, it is. And also one other thing too, people really need to keep in mind, Even if you go to the United States Constitution annotated, which is published and available for free download off of the Government Printing Office's website, they explicitly say that the case law from the federal judiciary actually supports the autonomy of the electors within the Electoral College. So that autonomy of the electors to vote their own conscience, which is not entirely dissimilar from when jurors in a court case vote according to their own conscience, regardless of the judge's instructions. Similarly, the electors within the Electoral College can vote their own conscience regardless of what political party tries to demand that they pledge themselves to a candidate. That's at best, that's extra constitutional. The Constitution itself says that there's Electoral College, the electors are selected or elected or appointed as per the various, under the purview of the various state legislatures. And quite frankly, after that point, the electors have autonomy, which means that they can disregard the popular vote. And many times they often do.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, yeah, definitely. And I think you'll find this interesting, Kyle. But I was down at our property in Southern Illinois this past weekend, and I finally had the chance to, I guess since I learned this, I didn't know this stuff before I went down there last time. But I was talking to some family members from Illinois, and I was trying to explain this to them. And it's a pretty simple concept, right, Kyle? But unfortunately, apparently it didn't hit home. I was talking to this guy, and he's like, yeah, that may be the case, but you got to keep in mind that Illinois is a Democratic state. Just look at like Cook County and places like that. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's the electors from whoever is appointed to however they're selected or elected here in Illinois. It doesn't matter. They can vote for whoever the hell they want to. But it's probably going to be Democratic. But I don't know. It kind of went over his head, and I just kind of gave up. Which is really an example
like that really just shows that there is such a thing as government propaganda, and there is such a thing as mass mind control. Literally. Mind control over people, that even if you go up to them and say, hey, the government's own monopoly laws say, even the Constitution says something completely differently, and you show them, you know, the legal citations and try to explain things as you know, you and I have tried to do. And notice his reaction, just the complete disregard. It's like, okay, so you really don't care what their own laws say. You just want to believe your own fairy tales and myths because some overpaid public school teacher, you know, basically blabbed at you when you were held hostage for hours a day for most days of the week when you were younger. Because that's what this is really about, is social engineering, fundamentally.
Yeah. Yeah, I definitely agree. And like I said, whenever we first discussed this, and obviously you've been studying this for longer than I have, Kyle, and you're a political science major, but once we talked about it a few times, like, okay, like it's not that it's hard to understand. It's just contrary to everything that I guess we've been told. I'll use a collective pronoun there for most Americans have been told, whether, as you mentioned, public schooling or mainstream media or whatever it may be. It's so contrary to what the mainstream opinion is. So I guess that may have something to do with it, but I'm pretty sure we laid it out pretty well right now, and also when we went a lot more in depth in that broadcast. Again, if you want to check that out, it's the 1023 broadcast of LUA Radio. You can find that on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, TuneIn Radio, et cetera, or you can just go to the website to find that. But that brings us to the action points and the reason for this evening's special edition, canceling the voter registration. So I have a page on the LUA site, so that's cancel your voter registration. You can find that at tinyurl.com/cancelvoter. And I guess just to give you a quick explanation, canceling the voter registration is one method of strategic withdrawal. It's direct action. It's cutting ties to the state. Essentially, rather than just being a non-voter, you're giving the middle finger to them, and you're saying, "Yeah, no thanks. I'm not going to participate in your fraudulent elections." So on this page, I have a PDF up there with 39 states. I might have to go back through and check to make sure all those are there. I have a feeling one or two of those might be dead links, but uh, so whatever it is, there's over 35 states where the process of cancellation is just laid out there real nicely for you. I did your work for you. And we've actually been successful in 5 states now. Illinois, which I did. Texas, which is what Kyle did. A reader listener in Indiana. A reader listener in Michigan. And in Ohio as well. So there's just some success stories. And if you go to that page, you can actually view the proof of cancellation. And now we get into what I mentioned at the beginning of the broadcast. I was going through Facebook and we had one of these Texas State Nationals, and we'll get more into that here in a moment. But we had one of those Texas State Nationals call into the show that Kyle was on that 10/23 broadcast. And he was trying to explain some of the stuff of what he believes in. And I went back to another person who identifies as a Texas State National, and I saw one of his threads on Facebook, and there was this link to a voter cancellation document. So I wouldn't even call it a debate. It's not even worth it to call it that. It was a discussion where I got accused of a bunch of shit. And essentially, it's an alternative method, I guess, to canceling the voter registration, even though it's nonsensical in every way whatsoever. So Kyle, we gotta talk about the sovereign citizens again. Damn it. But we did two LUA Radio special editions on this subject already. I think one was in May and one was in June. I think first one was sovereign citizens are douchebags. And the second one, the NLA ignores the fake judges refuse. The sovereign citizens are still douchebags. And you can find those on the LUA YouTube channel. But again, I'm going to reiterate this because I know I'm going to get a bunch of dumbass comments on YouTube. Sovereign citizens are just the catch-all. It's an oxymoron. We understand. We understand, guys, okay? It's the catch-all term, and we're gonna go with that for simplistic purposes. So, Kyle, you wrote an article a few years back, only on paper. And there are 5 different types of I guess now there are a couple more, but we'll say 7 types of these sovereign citizens. So why don't you talk a little bit about that article and the various types?
Well, back in February of 2014, so I'm not a spring chicken on this. In February of 2014, I wrote an article, the full title of which is Only on Paper, The Pathetic Story of Commercial Redemption, Free Man on the Land, Sovereign Citizens, Lawful Rebellion, and Community Immunity. And people can kind of look at that and maybe even follow along. It's located at tinyurl.com/onlyonpaper. And what's rather fascinating is that regardless of what specific label these faux or false common law advocates promote, there are some similarities. Probably the most important one I'll mention for tonight is their belief in the patriot mythology, specifically the corporate United States myth, which I have previously debunked alongside Gary Hunt, where we literally went through every single piece of evidence that's used to justify that fake myth, the claim that the United States federal government is a corporation. We went through pretty much everything. And the truth was actually telling a completely different story. The long story short, the United States federal government is not a corporation, whether it's in the sense of a limited liability, whether it's in the sense of a multinational or a conglomerate. It is not a corporation, but unfortunately, the sovereigns and company still very much promote that, and they've been really stubborn about it because, of course, if they don't try to justify that, then a lot of the other things they promote, whether it's the notion of like the so-called straw man, whether it's specific methods like accepted for value, which in a different article I completely debunked that particular method itself, or whenever they misapply Uniform Commercial Code, UCC, ultimately everything does trace back to the corporate United States myth. So fundamentally, the entire sovereign citizen ideology is based on patriot mythology. It's completely false and phony. And unfortunately, even though that article came out, the Only on Paper one came out, 2 years ago or thereabouts, People still believe in it. And not only that, if anything, from what I've noticed, and I'm kind of sorry to say this, but it seems to be more popular now than it was even 2 years ago. Despite my efforts to try and just tell people just and treating it seriously. I'm not dismissing them out of hand. I'm treating their ideas seriously and then seeing, okay, is this true or not? And the evidence, everybody, the evidence debunks the sovereign citizen claims, their ideology. It is false and phony as a $2 bill.
Yeah. Yeah, and there were a couple of new types, which we mentioned them kind of before, but Texas State National and American State National, and obviously a lot of that stuff seems. I used to believe in the corporate United States myth. I've been very open about that in article and in podcasts and broadcasts, but it even gets more loony than that. I mean, this goes perfectly with next thing we're going to discuss, but I mean. I've seen Judge Anna Von, or I guess the judge, yeah, I use the quotation marks, because, yeah, but, Judge Anna Von writes, writes these letters to Pope Francis, my dearest Francis, thinking that, he's gonna respond to them. I don't know, it just seems really, really silly to me. Kyle, what about, you're an article on fake judges, which has almost 2,000 views on the LUA site, the mirrored version, the fake judges, tell us a little about them, a little bit about them real quick.
Well, the fake judges was actually something I discovered completely by accident when I was actually working on explaining the events in Costilla County, Colorado, last year, which was mainly involving technically a completely separate issue involving nuisance abatement and people who owned their own land free and clear were being tyrannized and otherwise harassed by the Costilla County government and their assorted bureaucrats. A minority of that story about Costilla County involved some sovereign citizens who basically came in from outside the county. They were not locals. They basically came in and, unlike the county government and unlike the very hostile, that portion of those very hostile locals who were openly racist against the off-grid homesteaders, this outside batch of sovereign citizens actually successfully came in and busted up the off-gridders, the homesteaders that were there, which was known as SLV Just Us. And so the fake judges article that I wrote is in some ways a follow-up to the Costilla County story, because apparently the latest trend of the sovereign citizens is basically declaring themselves to be judges. And this wasn't limited, and why this is technically a separate story is because the incident in Costilla County involving one man by the name of Bruce Doucette was not an isolated incident by any means. Granted, because of that is how I found out about it, but it's much, much broader. There's these other individuals, you mentioned Anna Von Wright a moment ago, mm-hmm. who also declares herself a judge. There's also Gary Darby. He tried to intervene in the events that occurred in Harney County Oregon last January, involving the bird cage, some people squatting at a bird cage. and so this is kind of what happens, is that some of the sovereign citizens have been declaring themselves unilaterally and arbitrarily to be fake judges, where they have universal jurisdiction over the entire planet, New World Order. Where essentially that they can do no wrong and they can basically go around and do whatever they want, basically because, well, as best as I can figure it, they're a bunch of bullies. And it's very interesting to watch whether it's people who are quietly pushing back or people more, let's just say, brazenly, such as myself, really, really getting a lot of vitriol and nastiness. Sometimes from the fake judges themselves, other times from some of their sycophants, when, you know, I try to point out the bloody obvious.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, that's definitely true. And you mentioned, I guess, their shenanigans up there in Harney County, Oregon. But the trial for the C4CF folks, I guess the first set kind of came to a close. It did come to a close, and obviously there were a ton of informants, which not a surprise to me or you, Kyle. They really don't vet their people very well. So Kyle, tell us a little bit about what Terry Linnell had to say.
Well, Terry Linnell, who is an admitted informant for the federal government, she finger pointed none other than Bruce Doucette as being in Harney County, and more specifically at that wildlife refuge during January. So the fact of the matter is that Doucette is not just limited to what happened in Costilla. He was also in Harney. And while there were initial reports that did suggest that was the case, assuming Linnell is telling the truth here, then that would be the case too, that she finger pointed him. And not only that, but she also mentioned that Doucette also had some fake U.S. Marshals that were accompanying him, which of course does coincide with what happened in Costilla County, where supposedly the fake Judge Bruce Doucette was going to bring fake U.S. Marshals to come in and help the off-grid homesteaders. So there's this repeating of the formula that seems to take place here.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. And it seems like they just continually just keep pulling shit out of their ass. Because I know there was, it was like Continental Commander or something. They like the Continental thing quite a bit in their little movement. But yeah, I've seen some of those folks chime in with their fake ass titles too. But for more context, and we'll get into the Texas State National sort of stuff here in a moment. But some context is good first, so you understand why that's important and relevant. So Kylie wrote an article titled "A Primer on State Citizenship." Should tell us a little about that, as it is relevant to what we'll be discussing.
Well, this article came out in July of 2014, so again, not a spring chicken on this either. And yes, state citizenship is noticeably different from the so-called sovereign citizenship or their related versions like Freeman on the Land and Lawful Rebellion and all these other oxymorons, right? The fact of the matter is that before the ratification of the 14th Amendment, there was no such thing as a so-called United States citizen or citizen of the United States. To use an example or two, Benjamin Franklin was not a United States citizen. He was a citizen of Pennsylvania. George Washington and Thomas Jefferson were not citizens of the United States. They were Virginians, Virginia citizens. So when you look at the whole body politic of the early American republics, they were entirely composed of state citizens, not, I guess you could say, 14th Amendment citizens. So the takeaway here is that there has been over a century's worth of federal judicial case precedent that recognizes that there are, as of today, two classes of American citizenship, namely citizens of the United States, United States citizens, and citizens of a state, that is the state citizens. And the basis for state citizenship is right there in the federal constitution. It's known as the comity clause, article 4, section 2, clause 1, which very simply says, quote, "The citizens of each state shall be entitled to all privileges and immunities of citizens in the several states," close quote. So that's the point here, is that there actually is a basis for American citizenship, but there was like this pre-14th Amendment that has never been abolished, it's never been amended, it's never been changed, it's still there, recognized in the law constitutionally, but unfortunately the sovereign citizens like to, I've seen them do two different things, Shane, either they hop, skip, jump, and ignore the comity clause, or as the so-called American state nationals have tried to do, they co-opt it. They do refer to the comity clause, but then they say it means something completely different, which has to deal, again, ultimately traces back to either the so-called straw man hypothesis, the all capital letters argument, and or the corporate United States myth. So that's something, you know, it's kind of interesting. They'll take something that's true and then pervert it at best to a half-truth or just straight-up lie about it.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, definitely, definitely. So obviously there's a world of difference between state citizens and the sovereign citizens.
Yes, yes, there is. One is based in what the law and the federal constitution says. The other is based on patriot mythology and lies. Just mm-hmm. This is just common. I mean the sovereign citizens and freemen of the land and the community immunity people and commercial redemption, which deals with one way that they've invented to deal with uniform commercial code, which of course is why certain people end up in jail because they file liens against government agents. So that doesn't work either. Or they do something else like accept it for value. The whole sovereign citizenship thing is a pack of lies, which I'm really not seeing much of a difference between the sovereign citizen advocates and the federal government, honestly, because both of them unabashedly just straight up lie constantly.
And they both love paperwork.
Yeah, although between the two, I don't know. I think the sovereign citizens can give the feds a run for their money. I mean, it's really that bad. And also one other thing too I want to mention, if anybody was being really honest, the sovereign citizens are a mirror reflection of the government. They are essential. In other words, if the government didn't create them, they would still be around. It's kind of an inevitable consequence. So just think about that. You know, the sovereign citizens, you know, if they didn't occur naturally or organically based on patriot mythology and misunderstandings, the feds would have to create them.
Huh.
Think about this. For those of you that remember George Orwell's 1984, there was a reason for Emmanuel Goldstein. The whole point was to have a 2 minutes hate. The point was to have an enemy. This is straight out of neoconservative theory by Carl Schmitt. You need to have an enemy image by which to rally the entire society around. And so I don't really see much of a difference between the sovereign citizens and Emmanuel Goldstein.
Interesting.
It's that enemy image that the federal government kind of rallies around, and then they say that, oh, this is like the so-called domestic terrorists, or which is the new version or whatever. And then, of course, anybody who opposes the federal government, well, we have to like the sovereign citizens. They're opposing the government. The government doesn't like them, of course. So I guess you could say, in a word, controlled opposition.
Yeah. I definitely would not disagree with that. And Kyle, one thing I've run into, especially on the YouTube video, if you look at those two aforementioned LU Radio special editions on the subject, a lot of them obviously don't like the term sovereign citizen, and they think it was just created by the government. Now, is that true, Kyle?
No, it's not. In fact, actually, in preparation for writing the Only on Paper article, I exhaustively went through the sovereign citizen literature. All of those book reports are available on the blog. One in particular I want to draw attention to, because this answers kind of your question. The author's name was John David Van Hove, known more popularly by his pseudonym as Johnny Liberty. He wrote the Global Sovereign's Handbook. And in that book, he constantly, it was really annoying. I think I even mentioned this in the book report. He constantly used the term sovereign citizen, just relentlessly. And that book, I think, came out back in the 90s or thereabouts when he was still on the lecture circuit. So the point is that whether it was Mr. Van Hove or maybe some of the other sovereign citizens that I don't quite recall right offhand, if you go back to the older sovereign citizens, especially during the 90s, they themselves called themselves sovereign citizens. And not only that, they explained why they were calling themselves that, even though, unfortunately, much of that was based on patriot mythology and the corporate United States myth as well. The point was that they explained it. The term originated with them. So when you fast forward to now and you have the newer sovereign citizens, well, obviously, they don't even understand the history of their own, shall I say, ideological development. They've completely ignored their own tradition and what their own people, albeit the elders, what their own people did, because the newer sovereign citizens only in this very microcosm, let's just say a reality tunnel where they're blind to everything outside of their immediate purview, they've essentially ascribed responsibility for the term sovereign citizens coming from the federal government, when the truth of the matter is that the federal government only used the term because the older sovereign citizens back in the 1990s prolifically used the term to describe their own ideology in their various pieces of literature and books and so forth. So the breaking of history, the very ahistorical attitude of the new sovereign citizens and their willfully blind, I guess, denial or outright or outright just dismissal of their own tradition, their own values, their own history, their own elders is really kind of an object lesson for everyone else to kind of ponder about and take into consideration.
Yeah, and I can say firsthand that you're exactly correct. The way that I found it, I know a lot of others are kind of in a similar path. They find a person or a group or some sort of method they find on the internet, and they get focused on that one thing, and hardly any of them actually look back into the history of I didn't look back to the history of the sovereign citizens. I did look back into the history of the people in the group, though, and one of them already served prison time for doing that sort of shit. So he's a real idiot. He might very well end up back in there for similar things. It's definitely very, very, very narrow focus, to say the least. So any final thoughts on that, or do you want to move forward?
Just to say this, when people are trying to look for any sort of practical methods and or an ideology with which they can drape themselves in that gives a legitimacy and a way to resist the government, they really need to look into the track record. You know, how many failures have they had? How many successes have they had? And not only that, but even on the more theoretical side, like, does any of these explanations and these claims even make any sense? Whether we're dealing with it a posteriori or a priori. And unfortunately, the entire sovereign citizenship ideology is completely based a posteriori, which is fine because if something's empirical, that would also kind of imply, at least in some sense, that it's falsifiable. So when they say that, oh, the government's laws say this, therefore we're arguing that other thing, ergo, you know, do these like 20 different things and you'll be free of government tyranny without having to fire a shot, then that should stand up to scrutiny.
Yeah,
especially if they fall short, or as is the case here in reality, it falls horrendously short.
Yeah, I certainly agree. Let's go ahead and move forward to this alternative method of canceling the voter registration. Now, this document was authored in, I think it was 2009. I remember I saw that. Maybe not. I'll probably find it when I start reading through this. But I want to read both of these pages here. Authored by PAC, People's Awareness Coalition. Obviously, got to be copyrighted, right, Kyle? Because anything constitutional is good. How to commit the crime of rebellion against the Republic. Back in 1998, PAC brought it to the attention of Americans that it is a crime to vote. That's quite the claim. In order to participate, vote in elections in the United States of America, as to Section 2 of the 14th Amendment and its progressive updates, you must be a citizen of the United States, U.S. citizen. Since that time, there have been many people putting different spins on this without particulars, one being simply withdrawal of consent, an attempt to hide the truth being made. On page 2 of this paper, there is a letter to send to the appropriate offices. The purpose of this letter is to challenge the scheme of the current government, government singular plural, getting you to participate in the illegitimate reconstruction governmental system without advising you of the issues. And to learn more, go to a couple other pages. The nationalist parties of the several states of America, quote, political non-participation is the cure for the ills America faces. Wow. I'm going to stop there for a second. Political non-participation is the cure for the ills America faces. Kind of sounds like a silver bullet solution, and they're making a much larger claim than we are, Kyle. We're just saying, hey, this works, strategic withdrawal, go for it. They're saying that it is the cure for the ills America faces.
I hope they bear their burden of proof. Oh, wait, they didn't, did they?
No. Wow. Continuing forward, quote, tell them this is not my government. The Nationalist Party, God, this is so backwards. We'll get to that in a moment. The Nationalist Party is grassroots and pure for it, is of the common people of America. It is of the same makeup of those who settled this great land. It is a true party of the people, by the people, and for the people. We believe it is time for true change by exposing all other parties that are one and the same. We ask that you join us in educating America and repopulating the republics. So I'll read these, and this is before the 2016 platform, legislation without representation. We cannot participate in government. You people don't represent us. Leave us alone. True constitutional freedom for nationals of the several states. Please join us in constitutional freedom. Our goal must be achieved by the elections of 2016. Oh, they're going to fail. more information on the Nationalist Party at nationalistparty.us. So, Kyle, I get like just the little description letter. What do you think?
It's a little hard to be consistent and claim that as part of canceling one's voter registration, you ought to join up with some sort of minuscule, minor third political party that no one's even heard of and probably won't last more than 5 years. So that's kind of a clear cut contradiction. The only other thing I would really want to mention is that the framers of the Constitution themselves were firmly against the notion of political parties because they had observed the dangerous consequences that had occurred back in ye olde Britain, specifically between the Whigs and the Tories. Obviously, the modern-day Whigs and Tories would be the so-called Republicans and the so-called Democrats. So the whole point of having representative government was so that the congressmen, whether they're representatives in the House of Representatives or senators in the U.S. Senate, would basically represent their constituents, whether those constituents be on a more popular sense as in the House or the several state legislatures in the Senate, as was the case before the 17th Amendment, of course. So that was kind of the whole point, was that the congressmen were supposed to be representing the interests of their constituents, and you don't need political parties for that. This is very, very important. The whole notion of, for example, so-called minority or majority whips in the Congress is not even in the Constitution, and it's rather quite arbitrary and really quite tyrannical in and of itself. The fact, I mean, what is a whip? Oh, you must vote along party lines. I mean, come on, give me a break. So I think the takeaway here, at least regarding this particular element, is that political parties are thoroughly anti-American, literally. Political parties are anti-American, and on a good day, they are extra-constitutional and quite possibly unconstitutional as well.
Yeah, and well said. But before I read this letter, I want to just make a couple of points here. So if you go to their website, packandlaw.us, there's a couple of variations of that depending on where you go. But, you'll notice that, it's kind of a garbage website. You can't view everything on the left tab because they have like 35,000 things. I have a second screen that's like a 22-inch monitor and I can't even get to all of the stuff there on the sidebar. If you right click on the site, it brings up a quick menu. If any page you go to, it'll bring up a pop-up. Really, really, really annoying. But the worst part of this is that, obviously if you go to the Libertarian or Tax site, you can find everything without going through a paywall. But if you're just looking for basic information, you click learn more or something, it'll show you a little snippet and it'll say learn more by purchasing the Red Amendment. So it's a book. And that's pretty much what they direct you to each time. And the book is $60. It is $60. So you can't get any information, you can't get any proof until you purchase that book. So even when they made the claim on that first page, back in 1998, PAC brought it to the attention of Americans that it is a crime to vote. Well, they don't really bear their burden of proof there, Kyle. I don't know about you, but I'm unsatisfied. And apparently to find out why, you have to go and purchase this book. So that's definitely a problem. I was looking around also at their tiers, their levels, uh, for, I guess that you get more access to more information. And so, yeah, the first tier is $60, and obviously they haven't finished updating this yet. But I figured if tier one is just – if tier one is $60 to even access any information – once you get down to level four, you're probably going to be spending a lot of money a month or one massive membership fee for a year. So that automatically raises red flags, and it kind of raises the question, Kyle. What is their goal? Is their goal actually freedom, or is this just another cash cow that they can pull in naive people?
What you say reminds me a lot of what the commercial redemption scammers have done, where they have like different levels of membership. And if you buy these different memberships, usually it's at the tune of hundreds of dollars, if not sometimes more, then, you know, you can study the uniform commercial code. And it's like, yeah, you can go study the uniform commercial code on your own because it's already like available. I think they've even digitized it by now. So you can even look it up on the internet. You don't need a several hundred dollar so-called educational course by a bunch of self-declared sovereigns to basically learn what the UCC either says or doesn't say. So yeah. That doesn't make any sense, other than the only reason for them that I can figure that they would hide behind a paywall is because there's an ulterior motive, and that motive is to scam people, you know, to try and get something for nothing. And yeah. And not only that, but even back during the 90s, there were several so-called sovereigns who would sell various citizenship kits, again, to the tune of hundreds of dollars, a few of them even in the low thousands. And people would try and use the materials in those kits, sometimes involving accepted for value or things of a financial nature where you're trying to get free money that isn't free. And then, of course, oh, bada bing, bada boom, you know, oh, you're now in jail. So interesting how that works. You know, it's very fascinating to try and look that, let me put it this way, if people were to kind of approach this from a more objective viewpoint, if you just assume that the sovereign citizens are scammers, or actually, no, wait, hold on, let me rephrase that. This is a fun question for the audience. Ask yourselves, what are the differences between confidence men, con artists, scammers, and sovereign citizens? And if you can figure out the difference, feel free to email me at kyle@thelastbastille.com, because I would honestly like to know what the hell the difference is between a con artist, scammer, and a sovereign citizen, because I'm having a real tough time trying to figure out the difference, especially when you have things like, as you mentioned, Shane, paywalls.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's not even like, obviously, like there are a lot of people in the alternative media that they'll put a lot of content out for free. And then if you want to pay $5 a month or something for like bonus content, I mean, that's one thing. If there's a lot of material, there's some sites out there that offer a lot of material at nothing. But if you want to help support it, you can. There's no information as far as I'm able to find on their website. I navigated for probably 30 minutes before the show. Before we recorded this, and I wasn't able to. Right when my curiosity was sparked, I was dead end by the book. It's like, damn it, really? Like I'm trying to understand where you guys are coming from, and I just can't unless I want to shell out that money, for that book. So I want to go ahead and read this letter. It's titled "Letter for Termination of Voter Registration, i.e., Withdrawal of Participation and Rebelling Against the Republic." Copy all blue and red text and replace red text areas with proper data. State, county, attention, head of department, address, city, state, zip. Registered mail. You got to put that number in there. Greetings, head of department, serve party. Quote, it has come to my startling attention that participating in elections generates a person to commit a crime pursuant to Section 2 of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. Such crime is perceived to be an act of treason, which is based on the breach of political allegiance to my or a lawful state government that would have existed prior to said amendment. As such, operation of law is, simply put, unconscionable. I hereby formally and expressly demand that my name, as it appears herein presented, or any variation thereof, be removed from the voter registration rolls forthwith and canceled ab initio. I would very much appreciate a response from your department within 30 days of your receiving this claim, a demand which, 1, certifies the expungement of such registration, and the manner in which it was executed. 2, explains why this department acted in bad faith, inasmuch as it failed to advise me that it was involving me in such an artifice and scheme. If I do not hear from you in the time specified, by your silence, it will be deemed that you are a knowing party to this artifice, scheme, and my injuries will be figured accordingly. And the failure to certify that such legal hypothesis is not correct will deem it to be true and factual. I am greatly appreciating your full cooperation in this matter. Sincerely, name is registered, address, etc., city, state. Copies of the proceeding have been sent to the following. The State Attorney General. And then certified mail, obviously. And then the United States Department of Justice. The Attorney General. So, some alarming things there. Because if you go to the one on the Liberty Inter Tax site, this isn't some one-size-fits-all thing. There are 39 different states, 39 different processes for cancellation. They ask for different details and things. And you go to the county registrar. You don't deal with the federal government canceling your voter registration. Kyle, what do you think?
Well, you know, when I canceled my voter registration, I think gone on 3 years now, all I did was I just followed the laws and procedures as enumerated in Chapter 16 of the Texas Election Code. And there's different sections in there that pertain to specific procedures and what their laws are and such. But the fact of the matter is that this is a statutory remedy with the particular state government that, you know, you happen to live under. So you're right. This has nothing to do with the federal government, has nothing to do with the 14th Amendment, has nothing to do with anything of a, shall I say, national flavor. There's nothing national about any of this. This is all dealing with the several states.
Yeah. Yeah, and in that last paragraph, too, this was interesting. Quote, if I do not hear from you in the time specified by your silence, it will be deemed that you are a knowing party to this artifice scheme, and my injuries will be figured accordingly.
Yeah, that's an excuse.
What?
That's
what are they going to do?
Yeah, that's an excuse. You see, another, and this, you know, there's a method that the freemen on the land up in Canada really kind of pioneered, was the method of, I don't think there's a particular term, but just to describe it, essentially it's they're issuing a bill or filing a bill against government agents, like let's say like a cop beat them up or something, like police brutality. And then they say, oh, well, now I issued this bill and now you owe me, let's say hypothetically, like 15 grand. And of course, those were never paid out. So, and of course, if they were paid out, where's the evidence? Can we see, you know, where the check clears? Oh, wait, that's right. They don't like to prove a piece of paper and then distribute it over the internet and then act as if it's all legit when in fact it's not, despite the fact that whatever evidence in terms of canceling voter registration there is actually supports pretty much everything I've said.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. So there's definitely a lot of concerns, and I think we'll move on to the screenshots, and I'll put these in the show notes as well, and also on the YouTube video you'll see these on screen. But this is what actually sparked tonight's LU Radio Special Edition, and I guess let me make one note before I didn't redact the names. This was a public fascist book post. That, and as much as these folks are promoting this page right now, the document that I just read you, I would almost rather not protect the guilty. I don't know if they're promoting this. Public anyways. So just an FYI there. So. This was posted on October 30th, the original post says, quote, legally, if you have not canceled your voter registration, you are still considered to be a criminal and also considered to be in rebellion against your republican form of government. Article 2, Section 2, Clause 1, U.S. Constitution. Most do not realize they voted as something other than what the supreme law of this clause says, and this is how the SOBs did it. Ignorance of the law is no excuse. I ask most voters if they've ever compared the state voting rules with the U.S. Constitution. 100% have answered no. This is pure arrogance and why America is in huge trouble. Friends, compare the rules with the U.S. Constitution, and you'll be more than wiser to the trick of how these SOBs hijacked our 50 republics. Read and question everything. If you read it and do not understand it, there's a reason. Do not sign or perform a function in government you do not understand. So I don't know. Have you ever compared the state voting rules with the U.S. Constitution?
Mixing the jurisdictions much?
Yeah, that's I don't think that. Yeah, that's
Look, here's something people really need to keep in mind. Like, for years there's been different, and even Ben Lowry over in the so-called United Kingdom, you know, even he complained about this, and I do agree with Lowry about this, that this, that the sovereigns and company will criticize, will their attempts at a rebuttal, not even real rebuttals, their attempts at rebutting their critics usually boils down to something along the lines of, well, you need to go do your own research, with the implication that if you did your own research, you would of course agree with the sovereigns, because of course everything they say, you know, is basically the shining light, you know, of God out of his ass. That there's nothing wrong, that there's, you know, ponies and you know, flowers and such. You know, there's nothing wrong with anything they're saying, essentially. When, of course, the fact of the matter is that because Lowry did do his due diligence, and because I myself actually painstakingly for months in 2014, even the previous year in 2013, was painstakingly going through their literature and going line by line and then noticing the recurring themes and such. And so I took their, and like I said earlier, I took their idea seriously and then tried to judge it on its own merits. It's complete bunk. It's a lie. I can't emphasize that enough. It is, or to put it more briefly, it is because I did my own research that I oppose the sovereigns and company. So them telling me or Lowry or anybody else, well, you need to go do your own research, and then implying then you'll agree with us, is completely wrong. Because the only reason I disagree with them is because I took their advice literally. And I did do my own research. And the research shows, the evidence shows, and debunks all of their claims without question. I honestly, and I want folks to really seriously think about this for a minute. Have the sovereign citizens told the truth about any of their claims? Are any one, I mean, this is so bad, I can't emphasize this enough. Have any of the sovereign citizen claims regarding anything have ever been true, ever? I mean, my God, Ernie Turtelgate out of Montana couldn't even get it fucking straight, you know, whether the government agents in Montana are required to provide evidence of their oath of office upon demand. And when I wrote that article about Ernie Turtelgate not understanding Montana law, he, and it was worse too, Shane, he even quoted directly and specifically the citation from Montana Code Annotated, the MCAs. It's just, he quoted it and then basically put his own words into the laws and say that the law means these other things that it actually doesn't say. And then when I went and double-checked Ernie Turtelgate, and I basically wrote the article saying, like, I'm sorry, I don't know this guy very well. I'm sorry he got, you know, in trouble, something regarding phishing and resisting arrest, like victimless crime stuff. And I think it was wrong for the government to persecute Turtelgate for those various things. And I think he also got, a contempt of court and some other related things along those lines. But I said, but that doesn't therefore mean that he's automatically correct about this just because he said, you know, just because he makes claims. There was nothing in the MCAs that said any of that. And not only that, but at most it only applied, you know, that portion in context only applied to attorneys, not all government agents, including police officers in Montana. So there's also a scope of which government agents are we talking about, or, you know, shall we say government sycophants and employees and such. So, and that article of mine that year was my most heavily commented article, and almost every single one of those comments was just vitriol. So yeah. I want to kind of relate to people. I've experienced this for years, that if you step on or otherwise criticize the sovereign citizens for their own crap and you prove them wrong,
it's straight to ad hominems. They can't they just cannot refute you. As you said before, they'll just tell you to do your own research. And I was a sovereign citizen until I did my own research, and then I was not one anymore. And there's actually this wasn't the only, I guess, sort of it was on someone else's status, but it was some nonsense. And I posted your I actually gave him a link to your article, Kyle. And yeah, they didn't like that too much. And he's and he said something about, I tried to debate him back in the day. Someone who was opposed to sovereign citizens. I recognize his name, but I don't know him. And but he wouldn't accept. And I said, okay, sir. We'll just PM me, and we'll get that set up. No problem. But yeah, I messaged him. And he messaged back, and then it was just, ha ha ha, you guys need to do more research. And that was pretty much it.
So he straight up lied in two ways. Yeah. First off, They've never challenged me. I want this on the record, because people need to know that the sovereign citizens might as well be government agents, because they act exactly the same. Like, the only thing, and admittedly, the only thing I can't prove, at least as of today, is them taking paychecks as if they were informants like Terry Linnell. Like, that's the only part I can't prove, but everything, I mean, it just lines up perfectly. And that guy you just mentioned, look, they wouldn't even talk to me years ago, other than the comment section on the Ernie Tertelgate article I did. That was the closest it came to any sort of interaction. And even earlier this year, as was covered by the earlier LUA special editions, even when you've acted kind of like an emissary, or at least a go-between, and said, hey, you know, let's have some sort of debate. Like, you know, he's willing to debate now, and I still am. You know, it's just constant, you know, it's constant ignoring. It's a constant, you know, I'm evil or something of that effect. And notice also, so that's interesting. That guy you mentioned, he lied that I wasn't willing to debate them years ago. And he lied, or at least kind of implied, that I wouldn't be willing to do it now. And then when you actually put him on the spot, you know, you asked for the order. You ask him, hey, let's set it up. He's now saying you need to do your own research.
Yeah, he's like, you guys need to do more research. And like, obviously, there's obviously they kind of start with ad hominems, and then they go from there. But yeah, I was getting attacked on that status pretty vehemently. But yeah, that's typically what happens. So now what I'll typically do is just post like a link to. Whether it's like in this kind of instance, I'll post the cancer voter registration link, or I'll just post the link to your article and unfollow it, because I know a shitstorm is about to erupt, because that's pretty much the way that it goes. But I want to get back to these screenshots, because I think this will kind of start to make more sense as we expand from the document into, I guess the rhetoric put forth by the people that believe in this. So I just posted a link to the cancel your voter registration page, and I said, this is a much better way to find out how to cancel, and simpler too, it seems. And this individual responded, quote, it seems. Why would you say there is an easier way to do this? Why are you doing this? The PAC cancellation voter template gives them a chance to rebut what the letter is saying in it. If they remain silent on this letter's contents, it proves that they are aware of their fraud against us and the original state governments. Why would you not promote this PAC voter cancellation letter or template? Instead of that tangled can of worms from that very divisive website that has people's going every which way, but the way that they should, with those letters from your link, it is only or just withdrawing their registration. People need to see and learn that they are involved in a real fraud against them. Shame on you for trying to create division here. And this person doesn't know how to type, so I'm reading exactly how
Wow, you know, that kind of tactic right there, that reminds me of something Gary Hunt wrote about in his article Vortex, The Threat That Keeps Us Apart. That is something, that right there, and I want people to really listen to me at least this second if they've been tuning out a little bit for whatever reason. Listen, informants, undercover operatives, agent provocateurs do exactly that type of thing that you just described, that individual who was basically saying you were bad and all that. That is exactly straight out of the Vortex playbook that Gary Hunt correctly identified. So yeah, Shane, I mean, let me put an offer out to the audience. If any of you have any evidence, photocopy, scans, something solid I could work with, that shows a sovereign citizen accepting a government paycheck, please email me at kyle@thelastbastille.com, because I want to break the story on that in terms of firmly proving that the sovereign citizens are a controlled opposition, because that's the only missing link left is an actual paycheck.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, and that kind of surprised me. Like, we're kind of, I didn't expect it to devolve into this, because I mean we're promoting the same thing. I was just saying, you know, like it's finish this comment, and then I'll read mine, and then we'll discuss. But the person continues, quote, beware of the wide gate cutting corners. Hold on a second. So one boilerplate universal document for everyone in the United States is not cutting corners. But when I actually went through and did the work to gather up every single state, that's cutting corners. Okay,
yeah, sounds
whatever.
Like, sounds like the guy on a good day is a controlled schizophrenic. You know, where up is down, black is white, freedom is slavery, ignorance is strength, and so forth. I mean, this is just completely Orwellian. And so notice, now that there actually are people who are canceling their voter registration, and there's and many of them have been willing to put forward the evidence of that being successful, thus backing up like what you and I have done, notice that the sovereign citizens are now trying to co-opt that successful legal remedy, and they're trying to twist it and pervert it to their own ends and try to sabotage the reality that canceling your voter registration actually is a you know, bona fide legal remedy with the current government laws and such.
Yeah, and it gets worse. Quote, beware of the wide gate cutting corners. It never pays in the end. It is very important when dealing with these fuckers, pardon me, to make sure that every T is crossed and every I is dotted. Leave no crack open at all. Sealed tight. Pack voter cancellation letters, seal any cracks tight, and peoples are seeing for themselves how these de facto state fuckers, pardon me, really work and operate against us all in our original states. So, he's accusing me of cutting corners and making sure every T is not crossed and every I not dotted. But I don't know. I could put together one boilerplate document too and tell people to use it, but it would probably be a garbage document.
Yeah, and not only that, but notice he's projecting. Right, they accuse you of what they themselves do. That's very, very important for the audience to understand, is that the projection that the sovereigns and company do is par for the course. I have experienced this for years on end. They have never changed. They will never change for the better. And instead, you know what? If people are going to pay attention to anything, it should be this. The sovereign citizens are the devil's plaything.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. It's definitely a good way to put it. Let me finish reading this comment thread, because my response here is perfect. Obviously, I think it's perfect because I've said it, but, quote, it's hard enough to simply get proof of cancellation, at least here in the communist state of Illinois. If there's ever been an instance where they've responded to that letter, I'd like to see it. I'm asking for the order. Where's the proof?
Mm-hmm.
Quote, that said, division? No, not at all. The process of cancellation varies by state. There's no one size fits all for this one, as I demonstrated. Sorry, there's just not. Lastly, I promote it for purposes of strategic withdrawal, cutting ties to the state. I still have yet to see proof of what Thomas, and maybe you are, maybe you now are talking about. And no, I'm not going to spend $60 on whatever book he recommends. And she said, or I don't know if this is a he or she, the individual said, proof that you canceled your registration? The proof is in the receipts and copies that they received your letter. States do not have that control anymore over registering to vote as a U.S. citizen. It is all universally, federally mandated by the feds.
Law.
Yep. So your comment is really about not wanting to spend money on a book. Thank you for clarifying to me what is really going on. And this is pretty much where I just shut the person down. But yeah, pretty bad so far, right, Kyle?
Oh yeah, but keep going, man.
Okay, quote, that's nonsense. You don't contact the federal government to cancel your voter registration or to register to vote. You contact your local voter registrar. And again, what I said was this. Quote, if there's ever been an instance where they've responded to that letter, I'd like to see it. I've been able to prove cancellation for 5 states with my previously linked page. I'd like to see the proof of success of the one Thomas linked and any rebuttal that they have ever provided. Lastly, no, I don't want to pay $60 for a book. I've never paid that much for one. As you can see, everything on my website is available for free behind no paywall. If the book Thomas recommends is the solution to tyranny, the author wouldn't have to charge for it. People would see and experience the merit, and he potentially could even make more money off of donations and subscriptions, as he could reach a much wider audience. I don't appreciate jumping to assumptions either. But that concludes the conversation. But just so much wrong with that. So much wrong with that.
Yeah, well, I don't know what else to say other than they're a bunch of mythologists who rather believe in, I mean, hell, at this point, what's the difference between the sovereign citizens and, say, people who believe in that the president is popularly elected, right? I mean, both types of people are ignoring reality. They're ignoring the government's, I mean, regardless of the justice of it, they are ignoring the government's own monopoly laws. It's just they're just in their own la la land. I don't know how else to put it.
Yeah, and I want to mention one other thing. This was in the original post, but they continually say that it's a crime to be a registered voter. Well, Kyle, I don't think they're going to start hauling people off to jail for having a voter registration card anytime soon.
No, in fact, actually, the government encourages it.
Yeah,
but no, it's not. It's not a victimless crime. It's not anything. It's more dealing with an element of your status of citizenship at most.
Yeah. That's definitely true. And something I've noticed from browsing around that site, and also just that first page of the voter cancellation document that they promote, they kind of tie everything to the 14th Amendment. Yeah, a lot of bad shit happened due to the 14th Amendment. I'm not denying that. You aren't either. But they make this assumption that the canceling of voter registration has to do with the 14th Amendment, when it has nothing to do with that, as far as I know.
Yeah, it doesn't. It doesn't.
So much wrong. So much wrong. And one other thing I noticed from browsing the site is they call states countries. So they call it the country of Alabama or the country of Illinois. Which, yeah, I don't. Yeah, all of this just seems so backwards to me. Really, really does. I really don't understand it whatsoever. And I'll mention this again too. Which Kyle and I have discussed, they failed to provide any proof of their claims. I presented to them five states, as is available on the LUA site. I presented five different states that we've been able to verify it with, verify the process of cancellation, and they haven't provided proof that document has actually been effective. And on top of that, they can't prove their claims. Because you have to buy the book, which that's also another issue I have with it too. Now when I read a book, I can typically respond to you with the arguments the author is making if I think they bore their burden of proof or whatever. But I've asked a couple individuals that believe in this America or this Texas state national stuff or whatever state. For the proof that having a voter registration card is a crime or whatever. And that guy even called in, to the, 1023 broadcast of LUA radio. And I mean, he couldn't present his position in a concise way. They were hung up on the 1860 and 1864 election. And I don't know. They rely on that book a lot, and you would think that being smart individuals, they could break it down into a synopsis, and then maybe follow up on the documentation presented therein. Like I don't know a sources page.
I couldn't even tell what he was trying to argue. I mean, was he suggesting that maybe the election of 1864 was somehow unconstitutional because the Electoral College did not cast votes for President of the United States? I mean, I'm not quite sure what his argument is. And see, this is what I don't like with people who want to put my head on a pike, is that I find myself in the position of, before I can even begin critiquing anything, I find myself in the position of first trying to have to clarify what their own arguments are. And I shouldn't have to do that out of necessity. And of course, the problem with that, besides, of course, the fact I shouldn't have to do the extra work, is that there is a possibility I might accidentally commit the straw man fallacy because I'm trying to clarify something that I inherently disagree with.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's not good for me because of the straw man fallacy possibility. I shouldn't have to risk my credibility like that. And also, I shouldn't have to do the extra work of basically arguing my opponent's position by trying to get them to define something or whatever. No, they should present their position clearly in some way, whether complex or simple, but it needs to be clear. And then, of course, being a critic, I should just be able to just go straight to my criticism. But then, of course, if they're going to have something that's so ephemeral and so loose that we might as well be dealing with the federal government calling everybody an extremist, that word, which doesn't mean anything because it just bends with the winds of political expediency, then obviously they're making it, the sovereigns do this too, they're literally making it impossible for anyone to criticize them because there's nothing actually firm there. And I honestly think, Shane, that is a sophist trick, that practice of sophistry is deliberately done with the goal of basically shutting down or otherwise preventing any sort of criticism, because there's nothing solid for anybody to criticize. But yeah. Then they promote it as if it were something solid. You see the double think right there.
Yeah.
They promote it as if there's something there. But then when you have somebody admittedly being biased, but being the other side of it and criticizing it, it's very hard to even do that in an intellectually honest way, because there's nothing solid to even criticize. It's all ephemeral fluff. It's not even it's not even shades of gray, because at least with shades of gray, there's a gradation, right, from less to more and so forth, or from least severe to more severe, or whatever the measurement is for the shades of gray. But there isn't even that. So never mind, you know, black and white, you know, right and wrong. There's not even a firm thing, even in shades of gray, to latch onto and criticize.
Yeah, that's definitely true. And in preparation for this, I tried to, like, I told you that, you know, like, we need to try to understand, like, the Texas State National thing a little better, but you can't. I mean, I've been on a couple of their Facebook pages, and I've asked them many times, like, hey, can you provide proof for that claim?
Or how about a definition? Whatever
See, works. But yeah, I just got a response back today, and it was on that same thread, and it was the person who put up that original post, just tagged me and said, Shane's actually a pretty smart kid, and that's all he said. And I was like, okay, where's the proof here? Like, I called you out on in a response to this person, and that's all you're gonna say?
Yeah, it's kind of funny. It's like, okay, so I mean, what are you supposed to say to that? Like, what, thanks for the compliment, guys, but you completely ignored what I requested of you. And see, this is something else I don't like about the sovereign citizens. This is something else they do too. They expect everybody else, including the government, but they expect everybody else that you must answer. I mean, even the stupid document you just read, you must answer our questions. And if you don't answer our questions, we'll take that as some sort of like tacit consent or acquiescence. You know, silence is affirmation, right?
Mm-hmm.
We'll take that. And this is the standard we're going to hold you to, and we're going to make you accountable. They do all this kind of fake righteous indignation. Yet when the same standard is applied to them, well, now, who's being silenced now, Mr. Sovereign Citizen? Oh, wait, yeah. That's right. It's you and your ilk. Even when those of us in the alternative media, in good faith over the years, have asked, where is your evidence? What is the basis for your claims? And so forth. And pretty much it's, you know, mum's the word. You can't show us any court cases that support your position. You can't show any sort of documents from bureaucrats, if it's more an administrative remedy, for example. You can't show diddly squat. And the only reason any of us critics have been able to come to any sort of conclusions is precisely, as was mentioned earlier, because we've had to do our own research, as you yourselves have told us to do. And the results have led us to a completely different conclusion. So that's the problem with the sovereigns. They very much are the epitome of the double standard. They say everybody else, including the government, must abide by this standard, but of course they themselves are exempt from it. Now I ask you, Shane, doesn't that sound a lot like a lot of these bar attorneys, which, oh, by the way, the sovereign citizens claim are wicked, evil people, and that we're their enemies and such? Well, really, that's interesting, because the sovereign citizens are acting like a bunch of bar attorneys that they claim to oppose.
Yeah, and it's also kind of funny too. We came across these Texas State Nationals by them finding our couple earlier rated special editions on the Sovereign Citizens. They loved them, They aren't gonna like this one too much, I don't think. But
the point is that whether they're doing commercial redemption, whether it's the free men on the land like in Canada and Britain, whether it's the community immunity folks in Australia, whether it's lawful rebellion, which is still a more specifically British thing, or it's the American State National, as Anna von Reitz was very willing to, you know, shake her finger at me over when I called her a sovereign citizen. She said, no, I'm an American State National. Or as this other one you mentioned, the Texas National, whatever the hell it is, it's the same thing. They keep saying, no, we're not sovereign citizens, we're this other label. So they play this little semantic game, and then when you actually dig down into what their claims are, They are repeating the sovereign citizen formula constantly over and over and over and over again. So that's another layer of doublethink as well. No, we're not sovereign citizens, but we're totally doing the sovereign citizen thing, like perfectly. I mean, hell, even one of the so-called Texas national whatever the hells, I think he said something to the effect of, like, he expatriated. I think that may have been
In that broadcast. Yeah, he expatriated. Yeah, that's what
Which
he
is
said.
Why I asked him, like, okay, so are you doing the perpetual traveler thing like Pete Sisko, who is a guest you've had on before? And he's like, no, I'm not doing that. I'm still in Texas or something to that effect. So the point is that it's like, okay, so when he meant expatriation, he doesn't mean expatriation like how the government's own monopoly laws define and apply expatriation. He means some other bullshit thing that they completely made out of thin air, much like the Federal Reserve notes, right?
Much like the social justice warriors, but yeah.
Right? Or the neoconservatives when they complain about the Muslim invasion. Oh my gosh, besides the fact that actually the Syrian Christians are trying to like get here and not get vilified. And all that, you know, so it doesn't matter which authoritarian sycophants we're talking about, the neoconservatives, the social justice warriors, or as the case of what we've been here discussing, the sovereign citizens. It is just constantly vile and dreck and lies. They lie. Look, the sovereign citizens would be like the best politicians. Honestly, if the sovereign citizens were to co-opt the anti-libertarian Libertarian Party, I think they might actually win some elections. They're so slick. In some ways, I mean, think about it. I mean, they lie. The sovereigns and company, I think, would probably be some of the most successful politicians if they were to put their back into it.
That's actually
Look at the followings they've had. I mean, my God, these guys are treated like rock stars. You can't touch them. They're idols.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about, you know, being worshipped and such. I mean, you know, to put in a biblical reference, because, of course, the sovereign citizens love to quote the Bible and, of course, quote it out of context. But the point is that even for people who are secular, just understand the sovereigns really love their Bibles. You know, the kind of rock star celebrity status the sovereign citizens have would make Nebuchadnezzar really just kind of jealous with envy. Okay, and Nebuchadnezzar, as part of the head of the Babylonian Empire, he was forcing people to worship that golden image. Oh, jeez, man. I this is pathetic.
Yeah, it really is. So in regards to that, the document that they put forth, obviously, if you're listening to this, you're definitely smart people and you can make your own decisions, but I would definitely advise against using that. I don't see any reason to, and it's full of a lot of nonsense. So go to tinyurl.com/cancelvoter, or you can just go to libertyunderattack.com, go to the resources tab. Actually, never mind. Nope. Just go to libertyunderattack.com and it's right there, on the main bar, cancel your voter registration, and, make sure to open up that, PDF, with the, 39 states. The legal citations for the process of cancellation. And if you cancel in a state that we haven't verified yet, please do send us proof of cancellation so we can continue to bear our burden of proof while they sit there twiddling their thumbs or whatever the hell they're doing. And if you're going to cancel in a state that's already been done, and again, that's Illinois, Texas, Indiana, Michigan, and Ohio, and you want to send in the proof, I mean, hell, that's just more proof, right, Kyle? Might as well go ahead and do it. I'm not against it. So, tinyurl.com/cancelvoter. Definitely, go check that out. And if you're still registered, consider participating in a method of strategic withdrawal. So Kyle, any closing thoughts, for the listeners before I wrap this up?
I think that the people, the individuals that are promoting this fake, form of, canceling the voter registration, I think they honestly know about you and to some degree myself as well. And I think they are deliberately trying to co-opt it and steer it off into nonsensical crap because they know that we're being successful, that people are actually taking what we're saying, they're verifying and double-checking for themselves, and then they emulate us and then help us, you know, bear the burden of proof even more so by sending and making public their own voter cancellation documents and so forth. And
we're kind of making them look like fools.
We always have, right? And the sovereign citizens are jealous, and they know we're successful. And I think there's also something important, too. Like, I used to assume years ago that they were useful idiots. I don't think because of this latest move they're now doing, it wasn't even necessarily the fake judges. It's really trying to co-op canceling the voter registration, which I think really changed my mind about this. I think they're disingenuous activists. They know better, but yet they are acting in the way they are. So that's why I think there are ulterior motives at play, whether that be in the form of just, you know, the paywall and the book selling and such through that kind of deceptive means, or it's they're being jealous of you and I, and because you and I have more successes legally than the entirety of the sovereign citizen movement, if it could be called that, therefore they're trying to co-opt it, you know, and kind of like what the NLA basically, as you wrote about, what the NLA tried to do with committees of safety. They noticed that there was something burgeoning that actually was successful in Harney County and some other places before then, and so they try to co-opt it. And similarly, the sovereign citizens are trying to co-opt the voter cancellation thing in much the same way that the fake Judge Bruce Doucette was co-opted and broke up the SLV Just Us off-grid homesteaders in Costilla County. So notice that, and this is very important for the audience to take away. Every time there is a success, whether it's a minor success or a burgeoning success, where it's starting out small, but the potential to be really, really even more impressive than it already is there. The potential is there. There's some sort of victory or success, but before it has a chance to actually really blossom, like really noticeably, maybe even get into the mainstream, which would really be a nice change for once, the sovereign citizens move in, you know, kind of like during a football play. So you're, somebody's like going to the end zone, and then you have just this complete, you know, getting T-boned almost kind of effect, or at least the attempt to T-bone. I don't want to say they're successful. That's giving them too much credit. But the attempt to deliberately T-bone it and prevent, you know, or not the touchdown, but let's say another touchdown, because we've already had successes. You know, the SLV Just Us homesteaders were successfully resisting the county government. The committees of safety have been established, and there, you know, and hopefully there would be more on the way. And there are people that are canceling their voter registration. And notice with each of these, the sovereign citizens who have no successes, they are notorious failures. They do not understand the law. They are intellectually dishonest, and they are mean-spirited and cruel. Notice that every time there's success, like parasites that they are, the sovereign citizens move in and try to latch on to the success and pervert and twist it to their own ends just so they can make a fucking buck off of someone. That is despicable, and nobody should tolerate that for a second.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And yeah, the way you lay that out, yeah, I don't know when this, I think they've been promoting the cancellation of voter registration for a while, maybe. They said 1998 PAC brought it to the attention of Americans. So maybe they had this out before. But if they've had it for this long, they should have like a laundry list of successes.
It doesn't matter either way, right? If they're telling the truth, then yes, you would be right. There should be the laundry list, but there isn't any. If, however, they are lying, which I would at this point expect them to be because they've lied about everything else, then they're just trying to make themselves into big shots when in fact, they're a bunch, much like Donald Trump and his supporters who are, well, humping the Trump. They're a bunch of Johnny-come-latelys who come along and they notice the successful pushback against the social justice warriors, and they move in, just like the sovereign citizens, they move in and co-opt it. So notice that. Mm-hmm. This is over and over and over again. As a historical note, just for one more comparison, people might not remember this, but the Tea Parties were originally a libertarian project. And then before it even had much of a chance to get to kick off in the way that it did, the neoconservatives moved in and co-opted it and turned it into like this Freedom Works dick army. Let's hate on the Muslims for no reason, even though the original reason was opposing the banker bailouts.
Yeah.
So again, notice something has either a potential success or it's a minor success or something. There's something good there that's solid. But before it really blows up in a good way, they move in to co-opt it, twist it. And this is what the establishment does. This is how our enemy operates. They sabotage genuine activism for their own ends. And until people get this through their goddamn skulls, the effort to restore human liberty in these United States is going to be rather paltry at best, at least in any sort of collective sense.
Yeah, Yeah, I definitely agree, and it shows. I mean, kind of going off of what she said. I mean, this is a coalition. This is a big group, and just us through our peer-to-peer networking. We've done quite a bit.
More than they have, and that's why I'm glad you brought that up, because that's why I said in my article on disingenuous activists, that's why I've said organizations do not matter, but relationships do, that peer-to-peer, as you mentioned it. Mm-hmm. So there's no reason to have political parties. There's no reason to have these 501c3 nonprofits. There's no reason to have the 3%ers or the Oath Keepers or any of these malcontents. You just need to have people around you who are willing to work with you. And maybe people should consider exploring the concept of what some have called like freedom cells or more broadly, the notion of leaderless resistance. Because if we're going to talk about stuff that actually works, that's what works. That the evidence shows it. But again, that's probably a topic for another time.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely, definitely. So I guess I'll go ahead and wrap this up. Thanks so much for coming on the show, as always, Kyle. And you can find his work at thelastbastille.com. Kyle, thanks, man.
I appreciate it.
All right. Now, I guess I'll start with, if you're watching this on YouTube, please make sure to like, share, and subscribe. We definitely appreciate it. If you enjoy the show, please consider making a financial contribution to Liberty Under Attack. Just visit paypal.me/LUA radio to make a quick donation, or tinyurl.com/LUA Patreon to contribute monthly. I definitely recommend sign up for a Patreon subscription, just $1 a month. $1 a month. I'll give you an on-air cheers whenever we're live, or you can go all the way up to, I think, $100. But I mean, yeah, dollars fine. If everyone that listens just donated $1, we'd be doing very, very well. And for all the other ways to support us, just visit the website libertyunderattack.com, and just use the buttons on the sidebar to contribute. You can monthly PayPal subscriptions, Bitcoin, our affiliate links like Audible, and the Direct Action series is also available for purchase. That link is libertyunderattack.com/freedomnow. If you get it while supplies last, you'll get an LUA volunteer's koozie with your purchase at no extra charge. Definitely go check that out, libertyunderattack.com/freedomnow. Make sure to find us on our various social media pages such as Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, Google+, and YouTube. And also make sure to tune in to LUA Radio Live every Sunday and Thursday at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. Politics has never set the slave free. It's time for direct action.
If you're tuning in to this broadcast, freedom is obviously important to you. But unfortunately, whatever small fraction of freedom you have left is disappearing rapidly as Leviathanic governments continue to pass law after law, restricting your natural right to your person and property. You also know that freedom can't be won through the slave suggestion system known as politics. Things can seem hopeless, but freedom is more possible than you realize. Liberty Under Attack presents the Direct Action Series, your guide to finding freedom now without asking for permission. It includes over 40 hours of pure solutions presented to you in an advertisement-free format with bonus content. You can get your copy of the Direct Action Series for only $10. And while supplies last, you'll receive an LUA voluntarist koozie for simply supporting LUA. What are you waiting for? Visit libertyunderattack.com/freedomnow to secure your copy today. Again, libertyunderattack.com/freedomnow. And make sure to tune in to LUA Radio Live at 7 p.m. Central every Thursday and Sunday on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network.